Okay, hello, good evening everyone. Welcome to the new year of Mindset Public Talks. So, my name is Ahim Sam. I'm from the new School of Environmental and Geographical Sciences at the University of Nottingham in Malaysia. And I'm the co-director of Mindset. So, and I will give you a little introduction on what Mindset is, what these public events are, and then I will introduce our speaker for today. So, just so you know, this is a program of public talks that we organize every month, except for summer. We had a little summer break, so this is the third year. We're starting now the third year of the public events. And Mindset is a center that was launched 3 years ago, the research center, and the name is the UNMC Interdisciplinary Center for Environmental Studies. So then we have four main pillars in the center. The first one is environment, so, and of course all the work we do has to do with environmental issues. That's our focus, our main interest. But also we are getting interdisciplinary, so then this started from kind of natural scientists interested in environmental sciences, but I understand that we need to move away from the natural sciences if we want to work on environmental issues, on conservation issues. We need to engage with many other disciplines in order to move beyond just reporting problems and understanding how we can do something with these issues. Then our third pillar is about going beyond academia. So then we are academics, but our interest is to engage with different stakeholders. So this is our public arm. We engage with the general audience, then we try to engage with that being talks that are interesting for diverse audience. So then we have here students, we have academics, we have people from NGOs, from the private sector, from foundations, and that's the kind of engagement we want to have. And finally, we are trying to be optimistic. So then we don't want to just report problems. We all know that there are many environmental problems, and then we are very good at reporting that, particularly environmental scientists. We are really good at reporting population declines and many issues that it is absolutely important and necessary, but we want to focus also on success stories, on how to move on beyond understanding the problems, how to find solutions. So we think it's very important to identify success cases and try to learn from them what can be replicated. So I think today's talk is going to be very, very relevant in what I'm saying. So then it's really a pleasure to have Matthew with us. Matthew, go on. Carmen. I will not get it right, so if anyone of you can speak French, please tell me. It's the second time that he gives a talk for us. He came here before Mindset existed as such. He was one of our first guest speakers. And we really enjoyed his first talk. He's a historian. He's based in France in the National Institute of Eastern Languages and Civilization in Paris. But he's a historian looking at the human-nature, human-wildlife interactions. So then it's a very interesting perspective. It's not about current issues, but about in the last, today will be in the last 50, 60 years, but he has been doing work also in previous centuries. So then also I think today's talk will focus on some good stories about what kind of things have worked well in Malaysia. And it's something that we advocate a lot. We want to say that in Malaysia there are many environmental problems when it comes to wildlife. The target population is going down dramatically, the forest is going down, CFS, the linkages are being lost, but also we are in a much better situation than any other country in the region. So I think we should keep the balance between being realistic, but also not being over dramatic and not only blaming how bad things are going. And also kind of recognize the things that have worked well. And I think Matthew will talk a lot about this today. So then, just a brief description of today's event. So then we will start with Matthew's talk for about 45 minutes or so. He will talk about pioneering wildlife conservation in Malaysia, the historian perspective. And then we'll have a long Q&A. We'll have another 45 minutes for interaction with the floor. These kind of events, for us, is very important that these are slow nights. Okay, we don't want to just rush. We want to be able to listen to the story, but also want to be able to have time to listen from you and have an exchange of ideas. So So then around 7:30, we will close the Q&A, and then there are some refreshments here, and then you are very welcome to stay. And the idea is to have one-on-one interaction, a small groups, breakdown, and you can interact with people who have common interests. So I'm very pleased to see the audience today. We have a really diverse audience, and I really, really want to thank all of you, but I want to just acknowledge some of our legends in wildlife conservation in Malaysia, like Professor Lim in Bulyat and Wamin Khan. So the two people who are really, you know, for people who have studied wildlife, it's really, really exciting to have you here. So thank you very much for coming. And without any further ado, just 1 second, this talk is being recorded as audio, so then if everything goes well, it will be available as a podcast online. So then I would like to request you to put your mobile in silent form, so then that you don't spoil the podcast. And yeah, I'll tell you this.
Thank you. Thank you, Andreas, thank you for inviting me here tonight. What I will present to you today, so I'm an historian. I'm not an ecologist, I'm not a conservationist by profession. I'm just interested in human wildlife relationship. My main focus so far, my main field of research has been Cambodia and former continental China. So I'm pretty new on the field of Malaysian studies. What I will present to you today is the result of the research I did for the last 3 months here in Malaysia. So that's a work in progress. There are some points where I'm not totally sure about my findings, and I hope you can tell me if you feel I'm in the right direction or if I have missed something. I know that people are very knowledgeable here in this room tonight, and I hope it will be good to help me. As Hamza said, the situation of Malaysia appears as much better than in other countries in the region in terms of wildlife conservation. I was saying, my main field of study is Cambodia. As of now, wildlife in Cambodia is mostly gone. There's no more tigers, almost no more white elephants, no more celadons. All of those animals are gone. It's over. And when I came here in Malaysia, that was for the first time 6 years ago, I spent 3 days working in Malaysia, and I was very much surprised by the quality of the forest, the tracks I could see in the forest, and the amount of wildlife that is still possible to meet here in Malaysia. Well, Malaysia is one of the 17 mega diverse countries in the world. And I was wondering why Malaysia has been able to keep that quality of wildlife while other countries in the region obviously fail. As I was saying, I'm a historian. So I was trying to think about what's happened in the past. How what happened in the past here in Malaysia could explain that there's still wildlife in Malaysia. And not only when I'm very much interested in large mammals like elephants or tigers, because in order for those mammals to survive, to thrive in the wild, they need large area, they need large ecosystem that remain, if not undisturbed, least disturbed by man. Take the example of a tiger. A male tiger would have a territory, is territorial, so it would have a territory of 40 to 60 square kilometers, in which it would allow one or two female tigers to get in. But if any other male tigers get within its territory, it would kill him. So in order to have a large population of tigers, you need large territories of ecosystem where the tigers can survive. this question that I'm asking, why, about the past of the environmental, the environment of Malaysia, and the past of conservation processes in Malaysia, is not something completely new in historical researches. Actually, it's been 30 years that historians are looking at the history of what we call environmental history. One of the pioneers of this research has been John McKenzie with The Empire of Nature. In that book, McKenzie has been able to write the history of the conservation movement in the British Empire. And I will use his research. You've got, of course, the work of Mahesh Rangarajan, who is one of the main specialists of environmental history nowadays. He's an Indian, and he has another perspective than what the Western, that of the Western scholars. It's very interesting because he takes into account the perspective of the native people of the country that have been colonized by the West. Frontiers of Fear is also an interesting book. It's by Peter Bungard. It's on tigers in the Malay world. And the one that is the most interesting for me is the book that has been published in 2005 by Jiyamana Katere Tambi Wells, Nature and Nation, on the environmental movement in Malaysia. So, Professor Katere Tambi Wells has been able to retrace the history of that movement. So I will draw from her research too. But the, what really interests me actually is all the scholars made it clear in their research that first, the sharp decline in wildlife, the strong destruction of environment accelerated during the colonial process. Colonization was followed, accompanied by large destruction of fauna and flora. At the same time, because of those very fast destructions, some colonial powers, and mostly the British, started to be afraid that large part of wildlife would disappear, and started conservation schemes in order to protect wildlife in the empire. And those conservation schemes have been then copied all over the world. So if we look at the history of conservation, the colonial period is a good time to start it. And this is what I'll be doing. And what interests me is not only the history as the story of what happened, but what is very interesting for me in Malaysia, and this doesn't necessarily exist in other countries in the region, is how the Malaysians have been able to take over the British. In most of the colonies, conservation plans have been implemented. But after independence, while the colonizers were left the country, those conservation plans were discontinued, not in Malaysia. So my question is, why? And how did the Malaysian actually were able to make the truth that the British created for conservation their own, and how even they could improve those tools. So, I mean, just a short summary for those who are not totally familiar with the history of Malaysia. I know some of you are from not so historians. The British colonization of Peninsular Malaysia, I will only speak about Peninsular Malaysia, I won't speak about Sabah and Sarawak. So the colonization process of Peninsular Malaysia has been a long and slow process. The British came at the end of the 18th century in Penang. That was the first stronghold in Peninsula Malaysia, so in 1786. Then in 1810, they took Malacca from the Dutch. And in 1819, they created the city of Singapore. So those are the straight settlements that you can see in red on the map. Those are colonies of the Crown. They are directly under British rule. In the course of the 19th century, through those Crown colonies, the British were in touch with the Malay sultanates in the peninsula. And gradually over time, starting with Perak in 1874, they signed a treaty of protectorate with some of those Malay sultanates, and then all of them. In 1895, four of those Malay sultanates were put together in what was called the Federated Malay States. So that's Perak, Pahang, Selangor, and Negeri Sembilan. While Johor, and then Kelantan, Terengganu, Kedah, and Perlis that were added to British Malaya in the early 20th century, remain unfederated Malay states. That means that the British did not have the same relationship with the different the different states, as we call them now, in Malaysia. They had a very strong control on the straight settlements. They were able to impose their views in the Federated Malay States, where there was British residents who were not only advising the sultans, but in fact were exercising political power in the name of the sultan. But in the unfederated Malay States, like Kelantan, Terengganu, and most of all Johor, it was much harder for the British to impose their views. They had to negotiate with the Malay rulers. So because of that, there is not one British colonial policy in Malaysia. There were different policies according to the states. The way the British view wildlife when they arrived in Malaysia, tropical wildlife, is that it was a threat to them. It was bizarre, weird, dangerous, with beasts in the jungle. Here you have a few examples on how the British did view wildlife at the end of the 19th century and the very early 20th century. You've got, the resident of Selangor said that he doesn't wish to encourage elephant hunting, but if elephants destroy people's gardens, then they are at liberty to catch or kill them. You have a list of people who've been attacked and killed by crocodiles in Damansara, 1894. You have a poster that shows the reward that offered for the destruction of tigers in the Federated Malay States. So the British at first did consider the wildlife in Malaysia as pests. It changed over time. It changed mostly because of the fast disappearance of certain species, and species that were no harm to humans. The first species that started to disappear were game birds, or birds that were used for their feathers to adorn the hats of ladies in London or Paris. So those birds have been slaughtered by the hundreds of thousands, like egrets, for example. So in 1884, a threat settlement ordinance was taken for the protection of wild birds. It was then prohibited to export the feathers of certain birds. And those kind of ordinances were taken by Malay state, like Pahang. In 1902, the first game reserve was created in Malaysia, in Johor, in Perak. And in 1911, a Federated Malay States enactment was taken to protect wild animals and birds. But none of those enactments had considered an enforcement police, an enforcement agency. There was no one to enforce the law. There was a law, but no one to enforce it. So poaching was widespread, and people were continuing hunting protected species. So the in the 1910s, the British could see wildlife going down. They started to make censuses to try to count wildlife. And this is new. How many elephants, how many rhinoceros, how many saladans are left in the different states of Malaysia? Here you've got an estimate for Selangor in 1921. So you could see that in 1921 there were five rhinoceros still in the district of Kuala Lumpur. That's not so long ago. That's a district. It goes to Seminyak, for example. So, and counting those wildlife, and especially big mammals, they realized that their number was not very high. So they took a new ordinance, a new enactment, which was the 1921 Wild Animals and Bird Protection Act. And to draft this this law, they took the advice of Mr. Theodore Hubbard. Theodore Hubbard was a keen big game hunter. So he knew wildlife very well because he was used to kill it, to hunt it. But after a trip in Alaska, he started to be interested in conservation issues. He was at the forefront of the disappearance of wildlife. He could see wildlife going down because he was going to the forest to track animals. So that's him here. He arrived in Malaysia in the 1890s, first started as a civil servant, an engineer, if I'm correct. Then opened a plantation, and then settled in Kuala Lumpur in Pahang. He wrote several books on big game hunting, and writing those books, he became an authority figure on wildlife and how to manage wildlife in Malaysia. Here you have a letter from the Secretary to Resident Pahang, was explaining that the views of Theodore Hubbard needs to be taken into account in drafting the law. And actually, Hubbard was pushing for the creation of an enforcement agency in order to make sure that the law was implemented. He is probably the one who is at the beginning, the start, of what would become the Game Department, and later on Jabatan Nagastro, and then later on Jabatan Perlita. In 1930, Hubbard was commissioned by the different sultans in Malaya at the time, and the King of England, to head a commission on wildlife in Malaya. And here you can see where this letter is coming from. This is a letter to the High Commissioner, so based in Singapore, from Downing Street, asking to make Hubbard an official representative, an official commissioner for that wildlife commission. Hubbard was a nightmare for the colonial authorities. Each time he would disagree with them, each time they refused to listen to him, he would just go to London, to Downing Street, and ask to meet the Undersecretary for Colonies, who met him, and then they would send a cable to Sir Clement Tilley or the other governors, just to ask them to take his views into question. So, during that wildlife commission, Hubbard so organized a series of meetings. It was headed by John Hawkins, assuming 7, also 9 in pound. And in those meetings, they met British frontiers, but also Malaysians, who had the opportunity to express their views on WhatsApp, and especially on two issues. One was pest control. As I was saying, wildlife was considered a threat, threat to human, threat to plantation. And one of the aims of that commission was to assess to what extent wildlife was actually a threat. Then the second issue was wildlife conservation. What could be done, or what should be done, if anything should be done at all, for the conservation of wildlife in Malaysia. And so Hawkins and Hibak organized during more than a year a series of meetings where they met people from all conditions, so a lot of British planters, civil servants, but also Pengulus, so the people in charge of Mukim in the villages, Ketua Kompong, all just commoners, agriculturalists, Malaysian or Malay or Chinese planters, who could express their views on how they saw wildlife, what they felt about wildlife, and what should be done according to them. So, with this wildlife commission, Hubert was able to push for an agenda in conservation. He had in his mind different goals, different schemes that he wanted to implement in Malaysia. One was the creation of a wildlife fund, a fund that would be designed in order to finance wildlife conservation. Second one was the creation of a federal game department. As I was saying, the situation was different from one state to another. And Hubak was the first to say, it's nonsense. Wildlife doesn't know borders. So if you have a policy in one state, you need to have the same policy in the neighboring state. And the only way to make sure that wildlife is preserved in Malaysia is to make sure that the same policy is applied everywhere in Malaysia. And the best way to achieve this is to create a federal game department. And then he also asked for the creation of a national park. A park, a large wildlife reserve, and for that would be closed to humans. That would be only for wildlife. So, as I was saying, Hubert was not a busy character. He was a very bad-tempered person. He was very pushy, and so he tried to force on that agenda. He was recognized really as an authority. Here you can see that he's nominated as an advisor for wildlife in Kedah, which is an unfederated Malay state, so where the British had very little influence. So during 2 years, he pushed and pushed for his agenda. Here you have a memorandum he sent to the High Commissioner. And you can see the language. He's writing to the High Commissioner, the highest British authority in Malaya. We have failed in the Federated Malay States to do this for 12 years. It will not be necessary to fail for another 12 years because before that time, sacrifice would be complete. He's talking about the disappearance of wildlife in Malaysia. Then he has a series of interviews with the High Commissioner. See that the views of the High Commissioner, I told him definitely that a federal and Malayan game department is a political impossibility because of the organization of the colonial system in Malaysia. And he wants his national park, and I told him that there was not yet a Malay nation, the opposition that he has to face from the colonial authority. But Hubert and some of the people who were supporting him within the British administration were able to come up with a solution. So the federal game department was refused. It was not a solution. What they did was this. They created a position of chief game warden. The chief game warden was at the same time game warden for Perak, game warden for Pahang, game warden for Negeri Sembilan, then game warden for Selangor, and game warden for the Straits Settlement. Which means the same person was nominated in all the states. And in those states were nominated deputy game wardens, so one in Perak, one in Pahang, one for Selangor and in Negeri Sembilan. Those deputy game wardens could rely on the support of honorary deputy game wardens, people who accepted to be part of law enforcement without getting paid, free or for free. All of those wardens, most of them, if not all of them at the beginning and then most of them were British or Europeans. And then they rely on state game rangers. Rangers who were patrolling the forest, and those rangers were locals. And you have also honorary game rangers, which means that Malay, Chinese, Indian people agreed to do the work of a game ranger for free, not being paid. And so that's how it works. So there was this for the Federated United States and Straits Settlements. And for the Unfederated United States, some like Johor had their own game department that was not under the chief game warden. Kelantan had from time to time a game warden, sometimes yes, sometimes didn't. Kedah never had one. Perlis never had one. So this this was the first apparatus that was created in order to enforce game laws in British Malaya. One of the problems they were facing that there were very few people actually in charge. For example, for Selangor, you had one deputy game warden in charge of Selangor and Negeri Sembilan, at the beginning, one ranger for the whole state of Selangor. So here are the chief game wardens. So the first one was Theodore Back, who acted as an honorary chief game warden. He never was paid for his work. He worked on wildlife conservation for 20 years and never was paid for that. He even spent a lot of money for conservation of Malaysian wildlife. But he was such a bad temper that in 1937 he was kicked out. Even if it was free manpower, the British kicked him out. They invited a specialist of wildlife conservation from Kenya, Captain Ritchie, to come over. But as you can say, as you can see, Captain Ritchie didn't stay long. It didn't go well for him with the colonial society here. The British didn't like him. The administration didn't like him. Quebec didn't like him. And after a bit more than a year, he had to resign. And then they called from someone from India. I forgot him. It's here. Shabir. Peter Stanhope was a deputy game warden, was acting chief game warden in while waiting for the a new chief game warden to be appointed. So Shabir was with the Forest Department in India, and he was hired because he climbed the Himalaya. That was so he was a field guy. They knew that. So he came in. Then you see there's a gap, because 1941, that's the Japanese invasion. The whole British administration was dismantled. At first, the game department was dismantled. Actually, the game department headquarters was looted and destroyed. We lost all the accounts of the game department. But there was not nothing in between. Here, between 1941 and 1945, the Japanese started trying to rebuild a game department, but it didn't really work. There was some attempt, but nothing really really efficient. In 1945, so the British had to rebuild everything from scratch. So the acting chief game warden was Strong, who was actually the director of forestry. And a part of his position of director of forestry was also in charge of wildlife conservation. Shevia came back, took over also for a few months, and then Peter Stonehog, who was already in charge before the war, became the chief game warden between 1947 and 1952. Here, he was replaced by Jackson, one of his deputies, while he was on leave in England. Then was formed by Kitchener and Eastwood. None of those chief game wardens were trained. They were mostly planters, they were game hunters, and that's why they were chosen to occupy that position. They didn't have, except for Ritchie and to a lesser extent Chevier, they didn't have any training in wildlife conservation. They were just field officers who became chief game warden. And this is true also for the first Ketua Pelindung Nagastro, so the chief game wardens after independence. So James O, who was a planter, and he had he went only to elementary school, so he didn't go much further in his studies. And Benatron was an inspector of police, but he was an honorary game warden and then a game warden. The first one who actually received a training is here tonight with us. It's Mr. Mohamed Khan. He's the first chief game warden who was actually trained in wildlife conservation. So only in 1971. Also, you can see that the British stayed in charge of the game department until 3 years after independence. The Malayanization of the game department was a slow process. It took 3 years for the Malaysians to come up with a plan that would allow to do without the British. And from the archive that we see that in the beginning it was very hard for James O to occupy that position. Actually, nobody challenged the authority of Islo. Everybody challenged that of James O. His colleagues, his subordinates, nobody accepted his authority. But he had a very hard time at the beginning. So what were the missions of the game department? The first mission, the most important for the administration, was pest control. The game department was in charge of destroying wildlife that was a nuisance to men and agriculture. Here you can see a shooting of a rogue elephant in 1953 by, it was one of the, I think it's Kitchener. Here you have a diary of a game ranger. And if you check what he's doing, you know, for example, here is looking after somebody that is destroying plantations. Here it's elephants that are destroying plantations. It's even clearer. So you can see every day it's patrol, 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 and sometime tiba gajah sama-sama. They shot elephants. And when we read the diaries of the game rangers, we can see that most of the time it's patrolling not so much against poaching, but against wildlife. That may be a nuisance to agriculture. Actually, it's only the 1970s that this changed under Mohamed Khan. And he's the first one who actually changed the focus of the game department toward more conservation and also to find other ways of controlling wildlife, pests, than killing it. For example, the dislocation, translocation, sorry, of elephants. Second mission of the game department, enforcing game laws. For example, in here you have a letter from the game department archive of Mr. Din bin Mohammed Saad, who is asking the authorization to shoot a rhinoceros. That's been denied. Or here an investigation of an elephant that is found dead, poisoned in Gumpak in 1960. Third mission of the game department, the management of parks and reserves. Actually, after the 1921 enactment, it was easier to create wildlife sanctuaries, wildlife reserve, game reserves. Here are the most important ones that were created in the 1920s. And of course, the big park, which is King George Farm National Park, the one that will become Tamanega. That's the entrance of Tamanegara in the late 1940s. So the game department was in charge of managing those parks, make sure that nobody would poach inside the park, and also was in charge of managing the relationship between human and wildlife in and around the park. And last mission, study and conservation of wildlife. Actually, for Hubak, this was at the core of the mission of the game department. But the game department was so overwhelmed with pest control that they didn't have much time for study and conservation. Actually, most of the study, well, all of the study and conservation done by the game department was done within the parks, nothing outside the park. Once again, the first one who actually conducted research outside of the park is Mr. Mohammed Khan, who published a series of papers in the Malayan Nature Journal on elephants that he had to monitor, head of elephants, not to shoot them, but, for example, to see how they were moving from one place to another, and so on. And so conservation was something that the game wardens were very keen at doing, but they didn't have so much the means, nor the time, nor the training to do it. Actually, if we look at the archive, we can see that the game department lack of means, finance, manpower, equipment, ammunition. In 1945, they are deliberate for their guns. They had nothing to do. They could do nothing, no ammunition. Lack of proper training for the game wardens and rangers up to the 1970s. Poor coordination and authority between states and federal levels, I think that I understand still can exist. Poaching, of course, that was widespread. Encroachment on forest reserve and game reserves, extra. But actually, the action was not needed. It still worked, and we can see it in the files in the archives, because the game rangers and the game warden were very dedicated. I told you that many of them were honorary. They were not paid. They were spending their weekends, their evenings, their nights in the forest for free to protect wildlife. Here you've got two game rangers in Crow. It's a picture from the NG. Actually, Crow was one place where poaching was a problem, a huge problem. And when we see, I checked also the personal files of the rangers, actually very few of them have been dismissed for discipline under disciplinary action. The most famous one was a poaching case against Bernard Tong in 1969, that went up to 1971. But it's a very weird case. He was accused of poaching white pigs in town. It seems that some people wanted to get rid of him. So that's one way to get rid of him. But anyway, Bernard Chong and the other chief game warden, the rangers, were very dedicated people. When I interviewed them, Mohammed Khan and Dr. Limbuliat praised the quality of the ranges. Marvin Kahn was saying, ranges were my guru. They were my teachers in the field. And Nimbulgat told me they were good, highly dedicated. Most of the game wardens were depending on the rangers. So you had people in the field, officers in the field, even with them, not many of them. They lacked everything, ammunition, cars, even bicycles. They have to fill forms to ask for bicycle for months before they get one. And they still were doing the job. And probably this is one thing that we can't find in other countries in the region. I can tell you in Cambodia, it's not the same. So the game department was able to create a legal framework for conservation and more or less to implement game laws. But it still had problems. Actually, it could not protect wildlife alone. The game department needed popular support. And this is where a second actor comes to the picture, the Malayan Nature Society. The Malayan Nature Society, that's civil society and conservation coming to the picture. It was founded in 1940 by the chief game warden, Shibir, and a few British colonists. So it had around 200 members at the outbreak of World War II. And you can see 96% Europeans. It's a British club. It's very close. That's the colonial colonial administration, and also planters, which is quite amazing to see that planters were interested in wildlife. 30% of the members of the Malayan Nature Society were planters. So the main aim of the Malayan Nature Society at that time was to share about nature, wildlife, and so on, and to publish a journal, the Malayan Nature Journal. So you can see like an elephant track, some knots on Malayan bears, the Chewong of Khao. So it's like a series of small experiences in the world. Then, of course, during World War II, the society disappeared. But it was rebuilt in 1947 with the same people who started it. So Anthony Edgar was the secretary and treasurer of the society before the war, plus Gladys Lamar, who was the editor of the journal, restarted the society in 1947. In 1948, it had 260 individual members, so nearly 300 members altogether, so more than before the war. 20 members were already members before World War II, but 80% were new members. As still, you can see, it remains a club for Europeans. The big difference between MNS before the war is that there are more scientists and we can see an interest for science in the journal. But it remained mostly a club for nature lovers. MNS, after World War II, had a lot of relations with different research institutions. The Institute of Medical Research, that hosted the AGM, even provided a place for MNS to stay. And most of the researchers of the Institute of Medical Research were members of MNS. The Weber Research Institute, which was actually a founding member of MNS. The Forest Research Institute, that was very closely linked to the Malaysian Nature Society. University Malaya, and especially the Department of Zoology, plus the Museum Department and Raffles Museum, especially were linked to MNS, plus the Game Department. Two-thirds of the MNS presidents between its creation up to the late 1970s came from these institutions, two-thirds. Here you have the list of the office bearers in MNS. Actually, the office bearers, the committee, are the people who make MNS MNS. They are the people who decide of the policy of MNS. So in what was supposed to be yellow, here, it's more circular of fixed particulates in lab nature. Then in 1952, as you can see, doctors are coming in. The scholars are coming in. So MNS becomes more science-oriented, but still remains a club of people who are exchanging experiences on wildlife and nature. It changes dramatically in 1959 when John Wyatt Smith, a Forest Research Institute researcher, is elected president of MNS. Then Wyatt Smith changed the focus of MNS toward conservation. And it continued up to now. In 1968, the academics came back in. So even at some point, I don't remember what year, but there are only academics except for the secretary in the committee. So there was a very strong presence of academics. But the most important sheet is probably this one. There has been a slow Malayanization of MNS. I use the term Malayanization because that was the term that was used by the Malaysian government after independence for the administration. Already in 1947, the president of MNS, Anthony Edgar, said, "I'm particularly anxious that we should increase our Asiatic membership." MNS was always open to Malaysians, but it was not some kind of British expatriate club that is very closed. And you know, British club can be very, very closed. I was in India before, the British club in Mumbai was open to Indian in 2001. I give you an idea on how close it is. MNS was never that. From the beginning, Malaysians were welcome, but probably they were not very comfortable in mixing with the expatriates, with the colonizers within MNS. And here you have, so in red are the Malaysian members, in what's supposed to be yellow, the European members, the schools in dark blue, and the institution member in light blue. And you can see that even 1 year after independence, the large majority of individual members were British, or Europeans, and most of them British. So if we look at that, so only 24% of MNS members were Malayans in 1958. And half of them were school students. First Malayan office bureaus, 1959. MNS takes a Malayan name in 1963. The first Malaysian president of MNS is Mr. Wong Ye Kwan, a fellow of the Forest Research Institute. First test published in Bahasa and MNJ. Actually, there was a lot of discussion whether or not MNS should publish papers in Bahasa. And occasionally it did, but mostly used English as the main medium for the journal. And the last British president of MNS is in 1972, that's 15 years after independence. And then we don't have the list of members for 1972, it's lost. But we have the list of members in Selangor. And the Malaysians represent only 42% of the members of MNS. So even in the early 1970s, MNS remained an expatriate society. It's only in the course of the 1970s, and especially when Mr. Mohamed Khan was president of MNS, that Malaysian really, MNS became a Malaysian society. So MNS had two aims in these rules. First, to publish a journal. Secondly, to educate people about nature. And then it became not only educating, but raising awareness on wildlife. So in order to see how it succeeded, we need to know what the people felt about wildlife before MNS existed. And we have a tool, which is actually a superb historical source, the Wildlife Commission testimonies. So we have 723 witnesses who've been gave testimonies, and that included from 53 Malaysians. So you can see that the Europeans were mostly in favor of conservation, while for the Malaysians, the elite was following the Europeans, the village headmen and local elite, Ketua Kampong, Penghulu, two-thirds of them were in favor of conservation, but one-fourth of them still considered wildlife mostly as pest. For the planters and agriculturalists, two-thirds of them were considering wildlife primarily as pest, with testimonies like we need to strip Malaysia of its deers, we need to kill all the elephants, and so on and so forth. So MNS started programs in order to raise awareness and educate people about nature. It opened a school section in the Malaysian Nature Journal. And most importantly, it focuses its activities on schools. 20 schools and colleges in 1948, 157 after independence. And many school children have been introduced to wildlife through MNG or the activities of MNS. And that allowed a rise of awareness on wildlife and nature conservation in the country. And after John Wayne Smith started to be elected president of MNS, MNS started to lobby for wildlife conservation. Those are the first campaign that MNS launched. And it started with one campaign with the Serengeti branch of MNS in 1958 with the Ulu Pandan Nature Reserve. Actually, that was the occasion of a fight between the Singapore branch and the main branch. This is nothing new. Fight between the main branch and the headquarters and the branches started since the branch started in MNS. And the Singapore branch wanted MNS to be more aggressive toward conservation. And they succeeded when John Wayne Smith was elected. So you have the giant leathery turtle campaign in Trunkan, which was a huge success, except that it used a natural program that over time turned to be a complete disaster. Because when you take out the eggs from the nest, you change the sex of the eggs because of the temperature. And so nearly all turtles disappear. The Battle Cave campaign, that was a very hard campaign, tested over a decade to save Battle Cave. But that one was completely successful. In 1961, publication of the 21st anniversary special issue on nature conservation in Western Malaysia by MNS. And this is the year also when MNS became a member of IUCN. So you see, there's a shift in the activities of MNS. And this culminated probably in the 1970s with the campaign to save Taman Negara, when there was a project to build a dam on the river that's going from Taman Negara, I forgot the name of the river. Well, that have flooded Taman Negara, and MNS, the Game Department, WWF, fought that plan. Actually, what was more important is probably that MNS and the Game Department were part of networks that were able to reach to the decision makers. After independence, we are in a colonial system. It's an autocracy. So you just need to have a few people, different people. So game wardens, decision makers, and scientific communities were able to push for decision towards conservation. Here you have a few of MNS members who are very influential. Sir Chintan Ritesh Thomas, who was the governor of the Straits Settlements, and who was in fact the one who made King George III National Park possible. Malcolm John MacDonald, after the war, also pushed, and Sir Ghent and Sultan Abdulaziz of Perak were also members, ordinary members. They paid their fee, got the journal, and acted for conservation. What's more important to me is how Malaysians, when influential Malaysians, were attracted within the MNS network. So Sultan Abdulaziz died too fast to be really influential. But Tunku Yaakob Ibni among Sultan Abdul Hamid, so the son of the Sultan of Kedah and the brother of Tunku Abdul Rahman, was a member of MNS for more than 5 years. Tun Ismail bin Muhammad Ali, the governor of the Central Bank, was a member of MNS. Dato Mohamed Mahmoud bin Mat was a founding member of MNS. He was a Menteri Besar of Pahang. He was the first speaker of the Federal Council, the Legislative Federal Council of Malaysia. Tun Abdulaziz bin Haji Abdul Majid, who was one of the negotiators of independence and who became the patron of MNS. Dato Lobanto, a son of Lucky, so the team Tikkun, who put his fortune at the disposal of MNS in order to support conservation actions. So you have another network, kind of network that appears in the late 1950s, 1960s, with the game wardens, international conservation experts like Stevens, we won't have time to elaborate it, scientific community, MNS, that was a link to the general public, and the decision makers. And that allowed, like for example, the 1972 enactment to be taken on wildlife preservation, or the recommendation of the international expert Stevens to be taken into account in the third Malian plan in 1976. So if we look at what worked in Malaysia between the British, down the British, up to the 1970s, first, as a continuity, MNS and the game department started in the 1920s or 1940s and continue up to now. They were never discontinued, which is not the case, for example, in Cambodia, where there was a war, or in Vietnam. We don't have that. The ability for networking with very influential members, very influential figures, scientists, decision makers, game department, are bringing schemes together. And the ability, especially that's what MNS did and what now Jabatan Kelantan is also doing, increasing public awareness on wildlife conservation issues. Doesn't mean that everything was fine. When I read the file, I can see the lack of means, the lack of political support. I know that the people who fought for wildlife in those days really had to fight, had to put it hard. There's still a decrease in wildlife. Remember the slide I did show you with the estimates for Selangor. So in 1921, 166 elephants in Selangor, a few rhinoceros. In 1900s, 1960s, 6 to 10 elephants in Selangor, a few rhinoceros still in the Sungai Dulum Reserve, but that's it, And more, the shortcomings that have been the worst have been the dispersion of the Sundaicus rhinoceros in the 1930s, that could have been saved at the time, but it wasn't done for lack of funds. And more recently, the Sumatran rhinoceros. To finish, I will just show you something that will show you what has been done. That's a picture taken in 1935 by Theodore Bach in a place that some of you know, Jenut Kumbang. It's a salt lake in Taman Negara. Here you can see a Ceradan ball. This picture and series of pictures have been sent to London in order to assess the ecological value of the area around Bunningtown in order to create the national park. So that's 1935. So I went there to see how it is now. So this is where it is. So you see. In the forest, here you have a picture of the Salt Lake, and this is what I found. That was last week. So I couldn't see the Ceradans, but obviously they were here. And here's Tapir. So I want to thank you. I want to thank the person who worked on wildlife conservation for the past one century, because they allowed me to make that film 1 week ago. I would probably never have been able to see the tapir and the Senna on tracks without the work of MNS, the game department, the scientists, and so on, the people who worked for game preservation for over a century. Thank you. So I took a bit more time.
Thank you very much.
Oh. Okay, so we have time to discuss now with the public. And I want to start by congratulating you, because it's very unusual to see a historian who can do plots and can do figures with data, like a quantitative historian. That is really exciting, really something to appreciate. Also, I have been in many historian talks in which, well, it's a person reading through the text, and it's just, I often found kind of not so engaging, so it has been very, very good to see this kind of a historian who can make plots, he can go to the forest and identify footprints of tapirs or something. That's really unusual and interesting. So many of the things that we have been talking about are things that we keep on talking these days. We're talking about problems with enforcement. Again, we have good laws, but then who does the implementation, who does enforcement? Problems with a lack of manpower, so then one ranger for Pahang. But you know, nowadays in Balong, in Grand Balong State Park, we have how many we have now? 7 or 8? So the numbers are still very, very unrealistic for people to be able to do the job. You were talking about the federal state issues. So then again, it sounds familiar, so then creating a federal agency for wildlife, but you have a more kind of state-based agency for forestry. So all these things, I think that we all know. People here who work on conservation, we discuss quite frequently. So then, seeing that we haven't been able to find solutions to common problems. And so what I would like to discuss first is, in a nutshell, you know, in a very, very kind of compressed description, maybe that what is different from Malaysia with, you know, if you compare with Thailand or Indonesia or Vietnam, what are the key differences that have made, you know, the progress in the last century so different?
I would think that one of the main differences has been the continuity of the continuity of the work that's been done since the 1930s, 1940s. Except for World War II, there were not much interruption in the work that has been done in conservation. The second one is probably how much the people in the field are dedicated. And this means also that the rangers and the heavy town officers have to be chosen very carefully. We need absolutely good officers on the field. That makes a difference. And also, and then the third one probably, is the fact that you will tell me more about that, that the Malaysians nowadays support wildlife conservation.
Well, it somehow contradicts what we often assume in wildlife conservation circles. We talk about the lack of awareness, lack of engagement from the public. So we always tend to think that the people in other places, like in South Asia, they care more about wildlife. But I think your perspective is very interesting, how in the 1940s, 1950s, there was a genuine interest for these things. So they're talking about honorary rangers or wardens who were not paid for it, but you know they were doing it out of a genuine interest. It's something that probably we will not have predicted. People who work in conservation now, because you know people don't care about wildlife.
Even seeing agriculturalists, planters, people who do have plantation, protecting elephants or somewhat here is more important than protecting their own plantations. It's striking.
We are now collecting similar data, we're doing similar studies, and I think we'll be interested to see how these things match. I think it's quite interesting to think that at that point in the post-colonial transition, there was this background that favored. My own take on Malaysia is that it is one of the few places in Southeast Asia where we can afford to do conservation, wildlife conservation. So in the next 20, 30, 35 years, and Mohamed and I were met for a panel to discuss about conservation in Malaysia in 2015, right? Malaysia was these things. I think Peninsula Malaysia will be one of the few places where we can have elephants, who knows, the tigers, and then. But compared with other parts of the region where really things are going to get much worse. So I guess trying to find a balance between kind of appreciating the positive, but also not being complacent and admitting also all the problems. I would ask you, how optimistic are you about the conservation in Malaysia and in the region for things like elephants, tigers?
I think that the hard times are ahead. I've seen the poaching going on in Cambodia. I've seen the poachers. They are former Khmer Rouge soldiers, former government soldiers. They know the forest very well. They know how to use weapons. They are very good poachers, saying that they're rescued. The price of wildlife will go up because it will become scarcer and scarcer, and the market is still there, especially in China and Vietnam. So the pressure will be much stronger than what it is today. And I hear that actually foreign poachers are arrested by the dozens in Tamanegara. I'm not sure that Peritan and the decision makers perfectly understand what is coming. We need to link with wildlife department in Africa, especially, where we've seen that the poaching pressure has become something unseen. Using means like drones, sniper rifles, helicopters, this is what we're talking about. It's a kind of war, and we need to be ready for that.
So, just the last question for me. Do you think that the raw material in terms of people, you know, the enthusiasm, the kind of the commitment has changed from the people who were honorary wardens to people who are now going to the civil service? They might not be too excited about the, you know, being posted in a remote area. Obviously the same enthusiasm. What is your perception of where you have found it?
I didn't meet enough rangers and officers, but when I met Nshimwa Medesa, the superintendent of the national park, when I told him it's a good job you had, he was like, yes, very, very excited. I've seen rangers in Johor who told me that they didn't want to become officers because they wanted to be in the field. I think there are people who are genuinely interested. I don't know, actually they also can tell me that because they know that it would be what I would expect. I don't know them enough. I also need to spend more time with Peritan to know. But my first impression compared to what I've seen in Cambodia, for example, is very good.
Yeah, I think at some point I would like to hear from people like Mohamed Khan about about you know, how we can favor this profile question about wildlife to reach the water department. You know, how to make a public system that is conducive to be able to accommodate these kind of people, rather than having to very complicated system in which I don't know where we'll end up in which department or so. Then yeah, I would like to open questions to the floor. So then Mohamed Kante, you want to comment on yeah. Okay, so Otoli, yeah.
Actually, I think I was always in place while not doing the work. I was more interested, as a matter of fact, in small mammals because the nature of my work was more in small mammals until 1958, where I met this young man. We got together, he showed me some elephants, we had an exhibition, you know, with the aim of coming up with a zoo, the present zoo in Kuala Lumpur here. And I got myself interested in some of the large mammals, which I just look at it, you know, and get information and so forth. But I think what the question that arises here is, why in Malaysia? The conservation in Malaysia of wild animals, particularly the larger one, is more compact than most other countries in Southeast Asia. I had a feeling that socio-economic of the various countries has a very important part in the continued poaching of the areas. Malaysia, in the old days, was the top country in economic and so forth than any other Southeast Asian countries.
Actually, yeah, I think you're right. Beyond what I just showed, there are some factors that explain also why wildlife remains like a relatively low human density compared to other countries in Southeast Asia. Pretty high per capita income in Malaysia. But if you look at, for example, Outer Sarawak, Sarawak has a higher per capita income than Peninsula Malaysia. It has a much lower human density. And still, situation of wildlife is much better in Peninsula Malaysia than in Sarawak. So it's also because some people were doing the job to preserve wildlife, including you.
Sabah and Sarawak in the old days, the reason why Sabah and Sarawak produced more natural history books than any other country, than any other places in Peninsula Malaysia, is Sabah and Sarawak in the old days were mostly a lot of Europeans are there. In my time when I was there in 1952, when I climbed the mountain above you and did some work there, you know, I find that most of the people, most of the government officers in Sabah and Sarawak were European people. And Sabah and Sarawak has a reputation in the old days that most of the natural history, people were more interested in the natural history than any other place, than this revolution, than many. And that, I think, would encourage the other group of people. Eventually, that's why Sabah itself has more natural parks and all kinds of things to see. Then we listen to
it. Thank you, Dr. Mia. So, please raise your hand if you want to make a question, identify yourself, and then, yeah, let's keep questions for a long time for people to get in.
Hi, my name is Sarah. I'm from the UN Malaysia. I was interested to hear that you kind of said that the sentiment went from wildlife as pests to, oh no, they're disappearing and we need to protect them. And I was wondering, how did that change? I mean, there's that thing where, they're disappearing, but they're pests, right? So you should be happy that they're disappearing. So where was that sentiment coming from that we needed to protect them?
Yeah, then we'll take three questions at once, or we can have some Maxime, if you want to go to the
same time. Yes, thank you for the presentation, interesting. Well, just to come back also with the first question of Elisa, and so really the success of Malaysia, according to your presentation, is also due to MNS and the support of civil society. Do you have the similar kind of society in other countries in the region, or what is actually the crucial role of MNS in the protection and the conservation of wildlife?
So regarding the shift from looking at wildlife as pest to species that need protection, actually it started in Africa, the disappearance of lions, elephants, rhinoceroses that were hunted down by big-game hunters, and also destruction of the environment, led some big-game hunters, the very same who actually destroyed them, to wonder how to preserve them. And those big game hunters were closely linked to the royal British royal family or the high-ranking civil servants in London. And that's how, in 1903, the Society for the Preservation of the Fauna of the Empire was created. It's now Fauna and Flora International. And there was a shift in the early 20th century. And that came from the elite, from the British elite. And then it went down to the whole administrative system of the British Empire. That's also probably why Malaysia, as a former British colony, had more tools than former French or China countries that were under French domination. In the French Empire, the will to protect wildlife was not as strong as in the British Empire. And now for MNS, actually I don't know any other society in other former colonies in Southeast Asia like MNS. Also you have to keep in mind that the independence of Malaysia came pretty late, in 1957, one of the last one in Southeast Asia. So the British were able to stay a long time and to teach their views to nearly one generation of Malaysians. So I don't see any equivalent. Now what MNS did, it spread probably this idea that wildlife was worth preserving. And that came from the elite.
If I can also comment on Sarah's about the relation between a pest and to conserve, so that is the definition of a human wildlife conflict. And those things are on the rise, they are getting worse. And with all respect for people from Pakistan, I think if you go to all the Asian countries where you have tigers, many elephants, let's say elephants, it's a big different species, but all the elephant range countries, the 13 Asian elephants, and you ask, whether they have not enough elephants or too many elephants, many of the people who have to do the wildlife management, they feel they have too many elephants because they create a lot of headaches, a lot of problems. So they would like to have elephants, but far away in a protected area where it's like they're not around. But so then in most cases, most of the management that is being done right now is about mitigating the conflict for people, which is decreasing the amount of problems that the wildlife cause. It is going to be like this forever. In the human-dominated world that we live nowadays, tigers, elephants, they don't have space. So inevitably, we'll have to share space with them, and inevitably, we'll have to understand conflict. And that's something that we need to really understand. And it takes some time to assume that we want to double the number of tigers in Malaysia. But that means if it happens, tigers will eat 3-4 people per year. So it's the way things are. So then we cannot, eat a cake and have it. So then we need to understand that when I share space with wildlife, we're dangerous and being dangerous, there will be conflicts. And then communicating this to the public is very uncomfortable. So then politicians want people to be happy. They don't want to tell bad news to people. They don't want to say kind of not what people don't want to listen. So then I think that's an important thing we have to do in conservation circles, that is bringing this idea that conservation comes with a compromise. And then can we afford to lose 3-4 people to digest every year? It seems like a lot. Can we afford to lose, I don't know, 2,000 people to motorcycles every year? That's the thing. People don't seem to be so uncomfortable with the idea. So I think that's a matter of framing themes and putting the perspective.
Actually, on that matter, I was surprised that 3 years ago, Nostradamus choice was killed by an elephant in Sabah. And that made the news. And I was surprised by how the authority reacted. It was not that we need to shoot that elephant. It was, yes, it's a wild animal. The choice came too close. She was killed. Period. And that was a way to show that there is a resilience in Malaysia toward those kind of incidents. And we need that resilience to make sure that animals that do damage or kill humans are not primarily considered a threat.
Yeah, hi, my name is Carl. Just wanted to ask you, have you tried to compare the decline of some of these wildlife extinction crises? Have you tried to compare with the good old days, so to say, and then, let's say, the last 25 years? Because I think in the last 25 years, you've seen a slightly different picture. There was a lot of good work being done in the past, but if you take Cambodia, for example, Thailand, Vietnam, they had like 3, 4, 5 times more people than West Malaysia here. And only in the 60s, basically, West Malaysia started overtaking Cambodia in terms of human population. When Muhammad Khan, he started the SDG as well, that was also when the real challenges started to emerge. And in the last 25 years, we had 5 or 6 extinctions alone from West Malaysia, right? So have you tried to compare how it looks like, those trajectories in the past and then?
I didn't have time, actually. I didn't have time to go for the last decades. But what I can see is I just did a bit of field work in Johor and Taman Negara. But the head of sediment that I've seen is a huge one. The tracks, you can see it, I've seen the tracks. They were a fresh one, 24 hours fresh, and it's a large head. Something I've never seen in Cambodia, where I spent months walking in the forest. The other only country that I know is Cambodia, where conservation has been a complete failure. It's gone. We have a few remaining population, but very small ones. So I need to continue my work on this.
Thank you, Mickey. I thought that was really interesting. But I think in your last slide, you did a comparative study showing Taman Negara in the good old 50s and now. I think that's an expected result because Taman Negara is one of the better managed parks in Malaysia. While this study is really important, really useful, I think taking on what Carl said, we must be quite careful in how we interpret this information for policymakers. I think Malaysia now we're in crossroads. In the last 20 years, I think biodiversity indicators have shown that we have lost many species. In fact, we have even lost the Sumatra rhino from peninsula. Although I don't think the government has officially said that we have lost it, but based on nature, we have lost it. Tiger numbers, I know we had 3,000 when I was born, and now we have 300. So, while this is important, I think Malaysia, correct, we are best positioned, given our GDP and all that, to do some conservation initiatives. But I think there are some elements missing from the past. In the past, from what you showed, there was a really strong link between the rangers, the game department, and the scientific community, driven mainly by the Europeans. And this, I think, has slowly faded away. It was a time where, one time, the game department DG was also the MNS chair, and the frame DG was also MNS chair, but this has changed. So from little research that we are doing in Nottingham and the results that we are getting, there's a total or very little interface between science and policy and implementation, which was very vibrant in the past. That's one. Second is, we had champions in the past, where people were very passionate, and I know the currents were against them, and it's still against us. but we are lacking the kind of champions. And third from our research is, while it might be true that people who are very passionate about wildlife conservation at the ranger level, but many of them from my interview tell me that they're forced to take a job in Kelantan because they have no other choice. They actually wanted to be teachers, they wanted to be something else, they just wanted a government job. And now the way people apply for government work, the last is Kelantan, they get into Kelantan, and they've got a very different background, and there's no on-job training per se. So these are all things that I feel we need to put in perspective here in Crossroads. We're at a tipping point. So your research is very useful to show that illustrious past, but we need to present it carefully, because if you put the same perspective for Belum State Park, I think it's very different. Taman Negara is not a really good comparative because it's supposed to be one of the best managed parks. So this is just some input here of research. Thank you.
Now we're one of the champions.
On the networks, I think you're perfectly right. Actually, I didn't have time to elaborate. I skipped a few slices. I wanted to tell you about one meeting that took place in 1951, where it was discussed the dismantlement of the game department. And the meeting was chaired by Tunku Yakub. And first, they were discussing how to dismantle the game department. But Tunku Yakub was also an MNS member. And Lema, who was director of fishery, was within the meeting. And both of them changed the tone of the meeting, and not only the game department was saved, but the agenda in wildlife conservation was put at the top in that meeting. So, and when we see the route taken by the Stevens report, actually Stevens reports were sent by to everyone by Bernard Chang, and there was strong push to enforce the decision in. And recommendation in that report. Nobody cared. Until it arrived on the desk of Tun Tan Si Sing, who was then Minister of Finance. And it's him who spoke to Tun Kot Rahman about the report. The report arrived on the desk of the Prime Minister. And that's how it was incorporated in the Third Malaysian Plan. So, but this is possible only if you do have links, and that's something that I think MNS should look at, and Kelantan too. How to create links between the scientists, the militants, and the Kelantan officers, and the decision makers. That's very important to have that in mind. What was the question? And the rangers, yes, you're perfectly right. Actually, the rangers in those days were chosen because of their skills in the forest. They were good hunters or even poachers. They were recruited as game rangers, then stopped poaching. And then, nowadays, I heard effectively that today people join Kelantan. Not necessarily the forest, they are not especially at ease in the forest. And this is something that I create time to look at. It's crucial.
So, questions?
Thank you. I just like to say a few words. If I may. You mentioned Tun Tan Siew Sin just now. I remembered him. I was working as chief game warden at the time, and we were trying to get this legislation, the Protection of Wildlife Act 1972, to be passed. And it has been, hanging in the air for 12 years. People did the draft, but we couldn't get it through. So. I suppose he was a beginner's luck. I became chief game warden, and there was Tun Tan Siew Sin. He was very interested in hunting, in conservation, and then he called me quite often. I have to go to his office, and to what you call, you mentioned about what you call federalization of the game department. At that time, it was really a state and what you call a federal department. So you have the protection, the wild animals and birds protection order of 1955. The figurehead is the chief game warden. He's just a figurehead actually. And at the state level, you have the state game wardens, the state deputy game wardens. They are already people with the powers. So we wanted to bring it under one federal authority, and that was Tun Tan Su Sin. And we had to prepare a cabinet paper, and he, what you call, mentioned that the amount that has to be paid, you know, to what you call finance, all the state departments came to only 800,000 ringgit, or was it dollars at the time? You know, you were using dollars at one time. I say it's nothing. So that was how we managed to get this Wildlife Act through. We went to Parliament, and then by 1976, we got all the state departments under one federal central authority. Until now, I would say, you know, it's still the same. So we have some good, what you call, people helping us all along the way. It was not easy all the way. I joined the department in 1958. I was just a schoolboy at that time. And I was put to work with my rangers, you know, there was no officers. So I had to go with the rangers into the forest to drive elephants, actually. We don't like shooting elephants. And things were really difficult. It was a time when we just had independence and the country needed to develop. And the forest is where the land is. You know, they have to clear the forest. They have no idea. Well, how difficult it was. So much forest were cleared in a very short time. And I was in my home state of Perak and was working with the rangers, with driving elephants, and occasionally we kill one. That is the, what you call, policy. The game warden makes the decision. I was only an assistant game warden at that time. And would you believe it? At that time, I think we have something like 75%, maybe more, of the total land area in the forest. Today we have, you'll be lucky to have 41%. There's an expert from the Wildlife Department, Dr. Siva, he said we have between 21 to 44%. So that's not much. Give our tigers, and you know our tigers, has been declared as a new subspecies. It is now known as Panthera tigris jacksoni. It is named after the chairman of the cat specialist group of IUCN. He's a good friend. He has stopped working just like me. And it was named after him. So our tiger will have to depend on the forest of Peninsula Malaysia. So if you say 41% or 45% or 44%, how much is that? How much of it is this suitable for our tigers? So that is what you have to consider. We'll be very lucky to have about 20,000 square miles of forest left in Peninsula, and on top of that, how much of it is suitable for tigers? A lot of mountains, Gunung Dahan. I climbed Gunung Dahan 3 times when I was chief remote. It's all mountains there, and you don't see any tiger on climbing Gunung Dahan. So, and that is something that we have to. We are lucky today because I think that the public is more interested in conservation. You get a lot of people reporting to the papers, you know, talking through the media and, you know, complaining that this animal is being killed, that animal is being killed. And the Wildlife Department, I think, is doing its best. But even then, you see, we lose animals. Like, for example, you mentioned about the rhino, it's true. The rhino is gone. I think it became extinct in 2010, 2011. And it's a great pity. I tried very hard personally to try and save the rhino, but I think we failed. I think the truth is our Sumatran rhino is gone. Our Javan rhino became extinct in 1932. And I think personally, if you ask me, I would like to see all species in existence. You know, all species. Javan, I was hoping. We brought back the green peafowl. The green peafowl became extinct. And when I was still working, I was very interested in bringing the green peafowl back. And we succeeded. And we have a free-ranging population of green peafowl. And we have rhinos at that time. I still remember about 50 or 60 rhinos. And I thought maybe the next thing we should do is to bring back the Java Rhino. I have very good contacts with the Indonesians. And then suddenly we got all these problems, you know, we lost our sponsor. So that is something I like to mention. What I like to see in our country is to see that all species that were found in our country are found again. You know, they should exist. And then if, you know, there are places where they don't exist anymore, like the elephants, we have been catching elephants and we have been translocating them. I think 1,500 elephants at least have been captured and translocated instead of being killed. I think the problem at that time was the oil palm plantation. Elephants like to eat young, juicy oil palm, you see. So now the oil palm are grown, they become more compatible. Elephants and oil palm can coexist. There must be forests in these areas where they once exist. And possibly, you know, we are very good at catching elephants and translocating them, we can put them back. And this is something I would like to see. I'm not young anymore. I'm not past 8 years of age. Of course, my friend is younger than I. We are working together. And we are still interested in this film. So I think time is short. I think that's it.
Thank you very much. So, can we take a couple of questions and then you can ask her? Yeah.
Yes, Dr. Garand, you've sketched a very interesting map of the networks and such that prevailed in the pre-independence period. But in the post-independence period, we haven't heard yet about the role of corporations and companies in wildlife conservation. Given that private interests hold a very large part of Malaysia's land area in the shape of plantations and other things as well, what role do you see for them in these post-independence networks? I think it really, it's not just the plantations who may be faced with human elephant conflicts, but really other corporations that are otherwise involved, or either as a source of funds or as partners in conservation. What future do you see for them?
Okay, more questions. So I think there's one question here and one here. Yes, so you can start first.
Hello, my name is Amitabh from Rajasthan. Did you look at the evolution of wildlife regulations? I mean, the Act, the Ordinance, since 1884, the protection of birds until now, then while Tuan Mohamad 1972, Wildlife Act, and then the 2010, the amendment to the Wildlife Conservation Act. I think that's one of the reasons the conservation scenario is still intense. You said just now, you can still see the market in the general in Taman Negara. And also compared to Sabah and Sarawak is a bit different because the act is not possible there. So what do you think?
And we'll get the last question from Dr. Silva.
Hello. I'm sorry I was late. It's coming back from Bahar to rush for this talk. You mentioned about that, it's good to hear my former DG. So my mother is also here, and my sibu there, really learned a lot from them. But I think your study is very interesting in the sense that I'm also interested in this field, whereby the role played by the past officials, a lot of them, as you mentioned quite correctly, is that they did on a voluntary manner. And that, and many of them came from the planters, interestingly, because initially they were complaining about, I think many of them would not know about the Wildlife Commission, but it's a very interesting document, and I think it's still very much valid, and it should be it should be used as a kind of a text in some conservation field, where the planters eventually became conservationists, and also they had held the game warden's positions. And of course now it's more of a career positions here. But there's some of these individuals who took decision, and here I would like to mention, of course, not going that far back. I think Shabir was one of those persons who carried on Habeck's recommendation in Richie, I think he came as the first salary game warden in 1937. He was shooting elephants. Whereas Shabir came and then. So a lot of individuals were there, but coming straight forward in 1972 when the law was passed, I think not many people realized that the DG at the time took a very strong decision in stopping the culling of elephants. Before that, you could see the records that every year 20, 30 elephants being culled. And after that, so they had to come up with a lot of some other alternatives. This was a tough time because plantations being opened and so on. So we came into the translocating of elephants. And in addition to that, if you look at the old records, I think students can easily, there's another good thing that the department did was to produce annual reports. So it's quite well documented and there's a lot of data in it. And we could see that some businesses like taxidermies, there were hundreds of them in the past, and this was slowly eliminated. I think now to look for a taxidermist is so difficult in Malaysia. There are only two or three still alive, I guess, and there's no new ones. So this kind of the business on wildlife was eliminated. And you look at old archives reports, eating monkeys at the restaurants and all that, quite rampant in those days, and export of monkeys. So that individuals play a major role. You can have policies and plans and so on, but if there's no strong political will or a strong leadership, this would not go forward. And I think your study was interesting that we continued from what the British did. Another key factor, I would say, I think many people would agree, the English language. I think in many other countries, records were probably, in Indochina was kept in French. When the locals got independence, they discarded French. Once you discard a language, you also discard the knowledge along with it. You know? And recently we discovered the Japanese were also doing conservation work, but it's all in Japanese language. And to know that, you have to read Japanese, or it has to be translated into that. So I think there's a lot of interesting things in history, and I think you have really brought up something interesting, and I would really, I think maybe this would be a way to encourage others to go into this historical research, because we don't want to recreate the wheel. Thank you.
Thank you, Joshua. We have many students in this room who had to find research projects. So in history, it's kind of, you had the archives there. They're saying, so Matthew, we need 3 minutes to answer all these questions.
So on the role of corporates, actually the corporates started to be involved in conservation only in the 1970s. So that's the end of the period that I'm studying. And I'm a historian, so I'm working on the past. I'm not very good at podcasting. Actually, I had a very interesting discussion with Henry Barlow. I don't know if he's still here. Henry Barlow was a secretary of, MNS for many years, but he was also a planter. And he told me it just compartmentalized his life. There was his private life, where he was in favor of conservation, and as a planter, his fellow planters were mostly considering wildlife as pest or at best a waste of time. I think that in the period I studied, not many corporates were actually interested in weather. Some people within the corporates were interested and were ready to do something, but not the corporate themselves. Now for the interest of the corporate, that is something that is relatively new, even if it's now for 40 years. But once again, it's not something I study now, so I don't want to say anything that would be not valid. And as for the laws, I studied the 1931, 1955, and 1972 law. Actually, the structure is very similar. Each of the law is replaced by another one in order to make it more efficient. But each time, the main problem is the implementation of the law. Yeah, actually, those three laws have been able to create a legal framework that gave quite efficient tools to protect wildlife in Malaysia. I completely agree with you. The problem was to implement the laws.
Very quick question from Palo. Yeah.
Thank you, Doctor, for the insight of the history of MNH and also the wildlife. But I think you need to also consider looking at the history of our forests itself. Yeah. As far as I have known, our forest is a black area until 1990. Yeah, so which means people are not allowed to go in without a police permission or whatever. So this is what I heard, you know, but I never experienced it because by the time I come out of university, it's already free for all. Okay? And I think this is also the age or the era where MNH started conducting or organizing large-scale scientific expedition, started with the Rendah-Lombin, and then with the Belum Terunggo. Yeah? And I think the history of our forests, you know, the struggle the forests have undergone, you know, with Japanese occupation, then post-independence, then confrontation, okay, and then still a black area, we are still under Cold War, you know, sort of kind of thing, you know, with the communists and stuff like that. You know? So this area has been a no-go area, and I also acknowledge your saying that, you know, Malaysia is one of the, what do you call it, less densely populated. If you look at Thailand, 100 million people, you look at Philippines, 100 million people, you look at Indonesia, 250 million people. You know? So we are basically a land area which is surrounded by, you know, big population, and yet in Malaysia, you know, you find the population, no, I remember Nanjiana is about 30 million basically. You know? So that's not very big, you consider at that, you know, so the pressure from the people, yeah, to the wildlife per se, you know, has been very, very minimal.
Thank you. So, 30 seconds to work.
Okay. So, on the history of the forest in Malaysia, it's been done. Only ways in a dissertation covered this. So, I didn't want to do it twice because it's very well done. So, it's just with nature and find on the it was prohibited to enter Hutan Reserve without a permit. But the forestry department, and this goes back to the time of the British, always was very reluctant to monitor poaching in Hutan Reserve. Just say it's not their work, and they are too busy in doing their job in managing the forest.
Thank you very much. So then, to finish, I will just do a couple of announcements. One is, just watch out for new events. So then, next month we'll not have public talk because we are traveling, most of us involved in the organization. But after that, we'll have talks on Islamic finance and forest conservation. We'll have talks on citizen science, on animals in captivity and conservation. There will be a number of interesting topics. So if you're not in the main list, just let us know and we'll write down and we'll from you of these things. If you have ideas of topics that you want us to talk about, or if you have a great speaker that is passing by, you know, someone who is flying through Malaysia, just let us know. We are very happy to bring you new topics. And yeah, so looking forward to see you in the next events. And I would like just to summarize a couple of things that for me have been very important from this talk. And so one is the importance of will and the possibility. So then we know that things have been too bad in Malaysia compared with the context, compared with other countries in the region. But we know things are going really bad. So we know the trend is really bad. And then if we're complacent, things will be really bad. We have 10, 15 years to react. So then just because we are not in a terrible situation, we shouldn't think that doesn't matter. We have lost mountain rhinos, German rhinos, Swaziland is almost gone, we have lost a lot of forest. Clearly things are going really, really bad. So then we need to, from here, we need to decide what kind of future we want. So then will is important, and political will, we always talk about political will, but I would like also to emphasize the importance of social will, okay? Everyone, okay? All of us, not only say it's Najib's responsibility, which is, it's nice to say, but you know, we all have a part of this. And the second one that I want to highlight is the leadership and the champions. So then, Theodore Habak, he loved to kill rhinos, by the way. He was an eager rhino killer, but he did amazing things for the conservation of Malaysia because of his determination. I think in this room we have really fantastic examples of multiple generations of leaders, so then, from Dr. Lim to Mohamed Khan, but also people like Dr. Kartrehold, Nagu, and so many others here who you have been playing a role, Dr. Siva at the back, people who have really been instrumental in the last decades, since the 1950s to now. But still, it's a weakness we have in it, Luisa, and new generation. So then, but we need much more of this. Individuals with the ideas, with missions in life, they can make big changes. And in Malaysia, we need more room for this. And we need to groom the new generations of students. So I would like to emphasize that. So I would like to thank all these conservation leaders, as well as Matthew for the talk, and then of course.
If I may say, there's probably a need to change the opposition that is made in the discourse between development and wildlife conservation. It's like you have, in order to have wildlife conservation, that would be against development and vice versa. When we look at the data, actually, if we look at like Africa or Latin America, two countries that have the highest human development index in Africa and Latin America would be Costa Rica and Botswana. Two countries that made the choice of preserving wildlife. So there's no opposition.